the early 16th century, an Augustinian priest in Wittenberg called Martin Luther had new ideas about suffering.
What really sparked the thing for Luther was his own personal struggle with a sense of sin and unworthiness. Like so many medieval people, or late medieval people, he was obsessed with his own sinfulness and how could he get rid of his sins. And he describes how he undergoes all the penances and disciplines imposed by the Roman Church, and yet he still isn't able to find peace of mind. And then he came across St. Paul's words, "The just shall live by faith." And that was like a new dawn. And he realized that all that was necessary to attain salvation was actually just to trust in the saving grace of God in Jesus Christ. There was no need for penances and pilgrimages and all these disciplines, but it was all attained through faith.
Living by faith alone and doing away with the portrayal of physical suffering was part of the Protestant Reformation.
Luther didn't want to wreck the Catholic Church, he wanted to reform it, to move the emphasis from the image to the word. And that's reflected in this simple church.
There is no flesh and no blood here. There are no bleeding statues, no gory paintings on the walls. The simplicity of this interior reflects the Protestant effort to get back to the basics. Christian faith. The basic focus here is the Bible, the revealed word of God, that Luther believed Christians should read with their minds and embrace with their hearts and live in their everyday lives. Whatever the differences in denomination, Christians all agree on one thing. By suffering and dying to save mankind from sin, Jesus created a revolutionary new form of faith. Before him, pagan religions sacrificed animals to many gods. Jews sacrificed to the one God. His crucifixion was Christianity's ultimate sacrifice.
It is here at the altar, the ceremonial table at the center of all Christian worship, that flesh and blood will always be of paramount importance.
The ceremony of sharing consecrated bread and wine is the ritual that commemorates this sacrifice. In the Protestant and Orthodox churches, the bread and wine symbolize the flesh and blood of Christ. While some modern members might not realize it, the Roman Catholic Church goes beyond symbols. Every communion involves a miracle called transubstantiation.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the fountain of all holiness. Let your spirit come upon these gifts to make them holy, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ.
At this moment, when the words of consecration are spoken in the Mass, the bread and wine are literally believed to be transformed into the flesh and blood of Jesus. Those who receive them get a transfusion of God's grace to nourish their souls. So what have I discovered on my journey? Christianity is indeed fixated on flesh and blood. Both the beautiful, the physical body is one of God's highest creations, and the tortured, the body sacrificed for faith, Jesus on the cross, and the martyrs who died for believing in him. Why does the crucified, suffering Jesus attract the attention and even the emulation of so many Christians? Because suffering is something we all understand, since it is so much a part of life for so many through the centuries. It is a comfort to believe that suffering can be a way of connecting with the divine. But, I've discovered, Protestants and Catholics have different opinions. While Catholics have embraced a cult of physical suffering, Protestants rejected it in favor of a stronger focus on the written word of the Bible. But whatever denomination a Christian may be, flesh and blood is central to their faith. And that's because of a critical decision made in Nicaea in 325 AD. It was here that a politically charged debate laid the foundation of Christian belief today. That Jesus was indeed flesh and blood, true man and true God. And through his physical sacrifice on the cross, he brings salvation to all Christians.